Hi all, welcome to module P5. In this module, we'll be getting an introduction to client-side JavaScript. Client-side JavaScript refers to JavaScript that executes in the browser. We'll be doing a few simple exercises to understand what the power of JavaScript in the browser is. Before we do that, let's take a quick recap of what we've covered so far. In the first week, we understood that a browser can make requests to a web server through a network and receive responses from the server. We also looked at how code can be deployed. We use either the IMAD console or the local machine for development. We save our source code on github.com, on a git repository on github.com. After we have written code, we use the IMAD console to deploy our source code onto the computer which hosts our web server software. The IMAD console takes care of deployment and takes care of restarting the web server with the latest changes. When we were looking at the web server that we wrote a web server in Node.js, and the code was matching a URL to a particular function. The function can respond with text, or the function could respond with HTML. Just to go over some examples, this is what the code looked like. The first piece of code here is saying that if there is a GET request made to the URL /article1, use this function to determine the response. What does this function do? This function responds with the following text: article1 requested and will be served here. This is a text response. Similarly, if we look at the URL slash, in this case, the response is not a text response, but the response is a file. And this file is an HTML file, which makes this an HTML response. Similarly, for CSS, for the URL /UI/style.css, we served a CSS response, and so on for PNG. The browser, in turn, when it got the response, interpreted the response in different ways. For example, for the text response, it just displayed the text. If the response from the server was an HTML response, it converted that HTML response into a visual rendering and rendered the HTML. Similarly, for a CSS response, the browser did not actually show the CSS, but it applied the CSS to the current HTML document. And for the PNG response, it just showed the image. There is another kind of content that the browser can actually interpret and understand, which we haven't talked about so far, which is JavaScript code. If JavaScript code is given to the browser can apply the JavaScript inside the current tab or window and within the context of the HTML document that has asked for the JavaScript to be loaded. How can an HTML document ask the browser for the JavaScript to be loaded? It can ask for the JavaScript in two possible ways. This is one HTML snippet that adds a certain amount of JavaScript. So you can see if the HTML document has the tag script, you can write some JavaScript inside, and then you can close the script tag. This is quite similar to how CSS was added to the HTML document, but instead of script, we would have used the word style. So we would have said style and some CSS lines and then /style. So instead of doing that, we're using script. There is another way of including JavaScript in the HTML document, which is by referring to a particular JavaScript file. So you would do script src main.js, and assuming that main.js is a URL endpoint that responds with JavaScript, that JavaScript code is injected in the context of the current window or tab. The CSS analogs for this were style and link. So we use style to inject inline CSS, as this is called inline JavaScript. When we include the code within the document, it's called inline. So you have inline JavaScript or inline CSS. And when you refer to an external CSS file, we were using the link tag. But for JavaScript, we can just use the script tag. Just to show you an example of what this looks like, I head to my code console and I head to the index.html file. If you see, this index.html file is requesting for a particular JS file, but I can also have code that you write inline inside the document. Let's quickly commit this and take a look at what this looks like. And so you can see that our JavaScript executed, and you saw, hi, I'm JavaScript. If I click on OK, the rest of the document loads. So once again, because this is important to understand, this is what the browser is doing. The browser sees that the response contains HTML, and then the browser starts interpreting the HTML and starts displaying the HTML. The browser then encounters a script tag, and then it executes the JavaScript inside the script tag. So here you're saying alert, hi, I'm JavaScript, and that's why when the page loads, you get an alert box that says hi, I'm JavaScript. Here we're trying to include a JavaScript file. So it says script src equal to ui/main.js. And let's look at what happened to that request. So I'm going to refresh this to see what our network requests were. And I say okay. So here you can see that it tried to make a request to main.js, but it did not receive the JavaScript from the server, and the server responded with the 404. This is happening because there is no code here which is actually responding to the main.js. So let's quickly correct that by adding the main.js code. So let's save this. Wait for our server to restart. So there our server is restarted. And now let's look at the output. You can see that the main.js is now a 200, which means that the main.js has been served. And what was this main.js code? So what we can do is actually go to the tab called sources on inspect element, and you can see that main.js is a resource that has been requested. So if you double click on this, you can see the JavaScript file that was loaded, and this is the same JavaScript as we had here, main.javascript. Now let's go back to our app. So now if you look at what this main.js is doing, it's saying console.log loaded. And what this does is print out the string loaded in the console. And so that means that if I go to the console, I see the string loaded has been printed here. So we're seeing both the methods of JavaScript being used. First, this executes because this is there first. And then you see ui/main.js, which is being loaded. And once it's loaded, you can see that the JavaScript is printing this line here. Inspect element also tells you what line of JavaScript has caused this to be printed here. And in fact, if you click on this, you'll go back here. So now let's try to write some JavaScript and see what kind of things we can do with JavaScript. We're going to try to do four interesting exercises. One, we'll make an alert box, which we've actually already done. We'll output something on the console, which is also something that we've already done. We'll change the content of an HTML element, which is something we're going to do. And we're going to make an element move if we click on the element. So now the first interesting thing to understand is that I can actually write JavaScript inside developer tools, which is kind of the window that you get when you click on inspect element. And so let's go to inspect element. Let's go to console. So I can actually just write JavaScript here. For example, I can say alert, hi. And so you see that an alert comes up. I can also, let me just change the size. I can also say console.log. And so the string ASDF comes up here. Let's do something a little fancier. Let's select a particular HTML element, and once we select an HTML element, let's change the content of that HTML element. So let's look at elements to see what our HTML elements are. So we have an image, we have the content here. Let's say I want to change this content, right? So the first thing that I need to do is I need to select this element to be able to modify it. Now another way, like we had a class tag, another way to add a tag to an element or kind of label an element is using an ID. The difference between an ID and a class is that an ID must be a unique name, while a class can actually repeat. So many elements can have the class called center, but if I give it an ID called main text, only one HTML element should have the ID called main text. So now that I've given it an ID called main text, let's say var element is equal to document.get element by ID, and so I'll say main text. So if you click on element, you'll see that the HTML element is sort of represented here. Now if I want to change the HTML, I can just do element dot inner HTML, right? And you can just set that to a value, saying a new value, and you can see that the HTML on the document has changed. This is what JavaScript can do, and I'm writing this JavaScript in the console. This JavaScript code have also come from our main.js file. So now in our main.js file, we can just write, I'm writing a comment here saying change the text of the main text div. And so I can write var element is equal to document.get element by ID, main text, and then I can say element dot in our HTML is equal to new value, right? So if I go to index.html, I have to remember to change the name here. So I can say ID is equal to main text, right? Let's save this. Cool. So we have our alert box, and then you can see that this has already been changed because it happened so fast that we couldn't see it, and it was already changed to the new value. Let's now try to make something move. So let's try to make this image move if I click on the image, right? And let's see how we can do that. So the first thing to do is again get the ability to select this image. So let's go to our index.html and let's give this image a name. So let's call it ID is muddy. And now let's go to our main.js file and write some code. So I'll put a comment here saying move the image. So the first thing that I need to do is again select the image. So I'll say document.get element by ID img, and I can say img.onClick. So onClick execute a function. So here I'm going to write the function that should be executed if I click on the img element, and I want to move it a little bit to the right. So the way I can do that is I can change its CSS from JavaScript and say increase the left margin and make that 100 pixels, right? Make that 100 pixels. So let's save what we have. Let's restart our server. Alright, so you can see that I've gotten an error which says cannot set property on click of null. So let's try to understand what this error is. So the browser could not execute this JavaScript. So that means that it could not find img, and that's because I made a mistake. When I said get element by ID, there is no ID called img. It should have been muddy. So let's change this to muddy, right? So let's go back to our code. Save this. Let's go back to our browser, restart. And so you can see that we have not got a JavaScript error, which means that our JavaScript is probably executed. Now let's try clicking on it. So I clicked on it and it jumped a little bit to the right because the left margin had increased. And in fact, if you click on inspect element, you can see that a margin left property suddenly got added, right? And this did not exist before, but this got added because of our JavaScript. So now let's try to do something else. Let's try to make it move to the right a little gradually, right? And let's see what the code for that looks like. The way we can approach animation in JavaScript is by changing a property gradually. And the way we can affect a gradual change is by using something called an interval, right? So let's create an interval. And so this code that I've written here reads as every 100 milliseconds, apply the move left function. I'm sorry, this should be move right. So every 100 milliseconds, apply the move right function, right? And where is this move right function? Well, we don't have this function. So let's just quickly create this function. So function move right says that create a variable. If you have a variable called margin left, make sure that the variable called margin left increases by 10. And then set the CSS of the image and set the margin left of the image, right? So this will convert to a string called 10px, right? I'm concatenating the number 10 with px, but this margin left variable does not exist. So let's initialize that margin left variable. So margin left is equal to 0. So every 100 milliseconds, the move right function will be called. Move right will first increment the value of margin left, which was initially 0 and which will now go up by 10. And once it goes up by 10, the CSS will be set to that value. So let's save this. Restart our server. Our JavaScript is also loaded fine. The browser has not thrown any errors. And now let's click on this element. And you can see that the image is gradually moving towards the right. But you can see that it's a little jumpy. So we can actually make this a little smoother. So let's, instead of every 100 milliseconds, let's do this every 50 milliseconds so that the movement is more gradual. And let's change this value to a smaller value, like let's say 5 pixels. So we just move it by, or maybe we can even move it by a smaller value, let's say 1 pixel, right? So that'll be a slow movement, but it will seem to be a more continuous movement. So now let's click on Madi, and you can see the movement is a lot more gradual and seems to be a lot more continuous, right? The main things that we looked at in this module was that we can send JavaScript source code to the browser, which the browser will execute for us. The JavaScript can be inline JavaScript, meaning it can be embedded inside the HTML document, or it can be a separate file. The browser executes that source code only in the context of the HTML document that loaded the JavaScript. So JavaScript from one HTML document cannot affect the JavaScript of another HTML document, which might be in a different tab on your browser or a different window in your browser. We also looked at a few nice JavaScript tools in the browser that allowed us to see what JavaScript is loaded, and allowed us to execute some JavaScript or write some JavaScript in the console. And we also made some local modifications to the HTML using the JavaScript from the console. In this module, we've just scratched the surface of JavaScript. The point of this module was to introduce you to the kind of things that JavaScript can do and how JavaScript in the browser works. The Code Academy course to make an interactive website is a good example to learn and the kind of things you can use JavaScript for.